who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our transgressions, as we forgive those who are transgressing against us. And lead us while being in temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Absolute, infinite beingness, God, everlasting life, love, and mercy, manifesting yourself in yourself as the total wisdom and the almightiness. Enlighten our minds to understand you as the truth. Clean our hearts to reflect your love towards you and towards all other human beings. Amen. We repeat that the absolute infinite beingness, God, is the everlasting life. The nature of this absolute infinite beingness is life. In the absolute beingness, we see as its nature the self-sufficiency. This absolute infinite beingness is lacking nothing. In it is what we say the total wisdom. Apart from the total wisdom in the absolute infinite beingness and its self-sufficiency, there is also the will pleasure of expressing itself in itself, since it is the life, to manifest itself as life in all the phenomena of life. So, what else we see in this absolute infinite beingness? God, its multiplicity. In this absolute infinite beingness are beyond any number beings. These beings are composing the absolute infinite beingness. And these beings in the absolute beingness are similar to the absolute infinite beingness. They are not inferior, they are not lacking from the Father, absolute infinite beingness. Which means these beings have in themselves the total wisdom, the self-sufficiency. But no, how can we understand from our human intelligence the real nature of this absolute infinite beingness unless we have something tangible? What do we have? We ourselves as living beings. We are living. A human being is just a manifestation of the absolute infinite beingness. A living being. What are the expressions of the living beings? Knowing, themselves, who they are. That means the selfhood. We cannot have something from nothing. So, as we get everything from the absolute infinite beingness, as matter, mind, and everything else, so we are part of the absolute infinite selfhood. So, the main nature which we will understand the absolute infinite beingness is the absolute infinite selfhood. It knows who it is. If it is, it was not, how the absolute beingness would manifest the total wisdom? Now, the expressions and the manifestations of the absolute infinite beingness maybe are many, yet we understand only three modes of this beingness. The absolute infinite logos, the word, which is just expressing the absolute infinite selfhood. And also, dynamically, it's not only just the selfhood. Now, manifesting the absolute infinite beingness itself now dynamically, we can see in it the almightiness. Nothing is beyond its power. And then we call that manifestation the Holy Spirit. So it is the three states we can understand. The main nature of the absolute beingness, self-sufficiency, the will pleasure of manifesting itself, which is the selfhood, Christos Logos, and the dynamical expression, which is the whole creation is in the absolute beingness, which is the Holy Spirit. I said, there may be many, many other modes of beingness, but these three, the human beings and the human intelligence can understand. Now, we said that in the absolute infinite beingness, there are beyond any number beings. These beings in the absolute infinite beingness are similar. There is not any distinction. But passing through the manifestation, through the Logos, they have their own now expression. And we see these beings now expressing a certain order of archetypes, of beings. Then we have the holy archangels. I repeat, all the holy archangels beyond any number are similar to the absolute infinite beingness in the self-sufficiency, in having the total wisdom, and now passing through the Logos and through the Holy Spirit, through both these modes of beingness, they have their own expression. Now, the very moment the absolute infinite beingness and the Logos and the beings, that very moment, which is when? There was not any time that this didn't happen. That moment, from the absolute infinite beingness and the beings, start emanating the mind. I would rather call the mind more in the authority of the Holy Spirit, because the mind is the energy And the means by which the absolute infinite beingness and the beings will manifest themselves as the life. Now, studying the mind, we see that the mind, in the absolute infinite beingness, in the boundless space, is the super substance. The super substance is formless. Yet in this super substance, there is the total wisdom of the Almightiness, which is the cause of everything, the laws governing everything, the principles which are governing everything. So, the real might and power of the mind is beyond the world of forms. It is in the world of the principles, of the laws, of the causes. We shall call this the noetic world. Now we have the mind in lower frequencies of vibrations, which is again super substance and substance together. Now we see that in this world, the noetical world, the forms appear. Forms. What form? Beyond number forms. Because this is the total wisdom of the absolute infinite beingness. And why the forms are appearing? What for? To manifest life. Nothing can exist living unless it has a form, any form, from the amoeba, the worm, the butterfly, the birds, the animals, the trees, the galaxy, the planet. Is the planet living? Yes, the planet is living. The stones are living. The rocks are living. In the stones and in the rocks we have the crystals. It's life there. So there is no place to be conceived where there is not the life, because the life is the omnipresent, absolute, infinite beingness. So, what is the cause of the creation of the universes? The will pleasure of the absolute beingness to manifest itself in itself. And so, by the human intelligence and the human way of conception, we can just approach and study seven heavens. Now, which are these seven heavens? And from what are these seven heavens made? Definitely by the mind. It is the mind. So the various frequencies of the mind are giving me the heavens. Maybe there are many more, many, many more. Who knows? The archangels may know better than human beings know. But human intelligence cannot go beyond the seven heavens. And even those who can go to the seventh heaven, returning to the lower heavens, they cannot find words to describe the splendor of those heavens. And what are these heavens?
not only these seven heavens, and even more than these seven heavens. What are they? Joshua the Christ, who was the immaculate ray of the Logos directly incarnated and materialized into Joshua the Christ, said that plainly, the kingdom of the heavens is in you, in every one of us, which means every one of us can approach it, because it is in us, or this kingdom of the heavens, which means that we are God's. We live, and the nature of life is divine. Our expression as a self, as a self-conscious being, proves that we are God's. And as such, as God's, we can use the intelligence, express the intelligence, and use the mind for self-recognition to understand who and what we are. Then what we find? By concentration, the right meditation, observation, contemplation, you understand the various modes of life. Because all the modes of life are not the same. You have the life of the rocks, of the earth, of the planet, of the crystals, of the diamonds, of the metals, of gold, of everything. So we can study all these modes of life and find our place in these modes of life. Because we have a place in these modes of life, which is from the lowest to the highest. That is why a human being is called the microcosm in comparison to the macrocosm, which means in the macrocosm we have the absolute infinite beingness that corresponds to our spirit ego self. We have the logos, the logoic, super consciousness that corresponds to our soul, the manifestation of soul of the absolute infinite being. Then we have the bodies, our bodies, which correspond to the Holy Spirit, because we said that the Holy Spirit dynamically holding the almightiness of the absolute infinite beingness is creating the worlds and the heavens. So what we shall see now? Two states and conditions of things. The eternal in the absolute infinite beingness, never changing, everlasting, which is the absolute infinite selfhood, self-knowing. And of course, what I see in the absolute infinite beingness, eternal, I see it in the expression. Now, the expression is changing. The manifestations of the words are leading us to the words of the existence. Now, the word of the existence is in the word of the beingness. It's not separate from it. Because to exist, it means that it has in it the beingness. And so, we see the words of the existence. These words of the existence are the words of the various dimensions. seeing now the worth of the existence. We have the noetic world. I said the world of the principles of the laws of the causes. And then I have the noetical world, the world of the form. So that a form may appear, may be created, it must have behind it a cause and a law. And the law and the cause is all the time, in all the manifestations of the forms, controlling it. Because this is what we call the total wisdom and the almightiness. So it is not just simply because the Church or the Fathers of the Church mentioned these words to mean nothing to us, these words. Because in these words, there is great, great meaning which we must approach it with our mind, not just whispering the words. Because words are for meanings, to give meanings. So, we come to the conclusion. Every kind of a form is in the world of the existence. And it is the expression of the total wisdom of the infinite beingness using the mind now. We said we find the mind now as super substance. The world of the ideas, of the laws, of the causes. Now I have the nautical world, the reflection of these laws and causes to be formulated, creating the forms, all kinds of forms. And we said that the forms tend to serve life, to have now life. Life away from the source of life. No, in it, yet independent. These are the characteristics of the selfhood. And this selfhood is expressed by human beings and by the holy archangels. Now, what about trees and animals and parasites? Don't they have a self? No, they don't. They are the expressions of a hidden self behind them, which are the angels and the archangels, in their creationism, creating them. So there is a self behind them, but the forms are not expressing a self. This is why the human being is God. We cannot say a lamb, a cow, a lion, a god. Because all those are crystallized, materialized thought forms of the archangel. Elementals. So the archangels, using the mind, with their creationism and their wisdom and their almightiness, are composing all those living forms around us. The vegetable kingdom and the animal kingdom. And they implant in these forms life. But that life is their life. It's not independent life of the animals or the trees. This is the point. While a human being is expressing his own life, because he is God. So, we are similar to the archangels. As what? As human beings. Yes, and as human beings, but not absolutely as human beings, because considering ourselves as human beings our bodies, we are not different from the animals. As an expression, living expression, phenomenon of life, a human being is not different from the animals. Having the human form, which is of course the image of God, according to the Bible, yet we have bones, blood, flesh, organs, and so many things functioning to keep that human form alive. This is in the animal kingdom also. So, studying deeply, trying to find who we are and what we are, we understand what the animals and the plant kingdom are penetrating through this form. We see the angels and the archangels. Angels. The angels are the elementals of the archangels. Now, an archangel is a being, spirit, ego. But the ego, the I-ness of an archangel, is not exactly as the I-ness of a human being. There is a great difference in the expression, not in nature. In nature we are similar. There is no distinction. But in expression, we are different. Now, how a human being has been created? We go back to the Old Testament. There is stated that God, the absolute infinite beingness, said, that means expressed as logos, the will pleasure to whom? Let us create man to our image and according to our likeness. Not different. Of course we know that he said that to the other gods, the archangels, the lords of the elements. He said that. Which means in which language? That means the absolute infinite beingness vibrating the total wisdom, such as vibrating the same in the archangels. That was not given an order, because the will pleasure of the infinite beingness was the will pleasure also of the archangels. And of us as spirit soul egos. So we also have created our own material self. What happens then? One ray, not more, of our real self, which never departed from God as spirit, started projecting itself in itself, in the absolute beingness, and from that moment the spirit, ego self, becomes also, without changing, as our soul. So, according to the study of the Great One, and anyone even now can approach this truth, from the great throne of the archangels, another ray of an archangel of the thrones descended, had been equified with the soul, becoming our guardian archangel. So we have the two in one, equified. What does it mean, equified? By at one man becoming one, yet not being one in nature, in expression being one. Then, let us make man to our image and according to our likeness, or the other archangels, similar in the absolute beingness, now manifest their separate self as Michaels, Gabriels, Raphaels, Uriels, Cherubs, Seraphs, to start their own work. A great honor for a human being. You know that you are in your material bodies and in the etheric double and the psychical body and the etheric double and the nautical body of yours. You are living in it now, in a body, in a material body. A Michael is working, a Raphael is working, a Gabriel is working, a Uriel is working, the seraphs and the cherubs are working. Now, this moment, just to keep your material bodies alive. Is that not a great, great honor? Do we appreciate that? Do we know that? By introspection and serious study, we'll come to know all these things and even come in self-conscious contact with these archangels. Know them. And when we do that, entering the so-called self-realization, according to Joshua the Christ, he said, joy is to your angels in heaven, which is in you, for one who returns back to his nature, back home. So, a Michael is arranging in your material bodies the necessary heat, the temperature. That's not you as a person doing that. A Gabriel is providing the liquids in the body. Shamal is providing the earth of it, the skeleton, and many other matter, not substance. Let us call it substance, though it is matter and not substance. And then Uriel is balancing the things to keep them in order. Raphael is giving the etheric vitality in our bodies. They all cooperate wisely, creating the red warm blood in our bodies only, not in the animals also. And something like the blood is in the trees, liquids going up the trunk to feed the leaves. So, studying the nature around you, you'll be wondering at the total wisdom and the almightiness of these archangels, the lords of the elements, and of the logos. Now, studying the things around us, we study the nature of the archangels and the angels. Studying our nature now, as a personality, our personal self, we can approach the logos, because the law of life, selfhood, is the logos. Now, what is the relation between Joshua Emmanuel the Christ with the logos? What is the relation? There must be a relationship between them. Of course, a wise one. Buddha, Bodhisattva, Buddha, predicted the coming of the one God in a human being directly, without ascending the scale of reincarnations. Because before passing away, he said to his disciples, 500 years from today, God himself will be humanized. This is what they had, the wise men of this, in their mind, the time, and they came just to worship Joshua the Christ, the time of his birth. Now, we shall recognize now the relationship between Joshua the Christ, a young man who lived only 33 years. Did he live more? They crucified him. But what was that young man, Joshua, Emmanuel, the Christ, to the Logos? Because the Logos was always, that was the good pleasure of the infinite absolute beingness. The ocean, the boundless ocean of life. And what it can be now, Joshua, a human being, a young man, a man just like any one of us. Yes, that young man knew from the very beginning who he was, and he knew and was calling himself Son of God. He knew it. And he has proved it with what he was doing, with all his life. And knowing Joshua before his crucifixion, when the Pharisees came provoking him, he said, before the foundation of the world, before Abraham, I am. I am. He didn't say I was. Because he was speaking in the eternal now. So that means Joshua, the God-man, so we must call him, was God, perfect God, being in his material body. And when, of course, they questioned about that, the Pharisees and others said, you don't believe. Telling you that I am the Son of God, and God, believe to the works I am doing. So, Joshua existed 20 centuries. For 33 years, existed, was, all through the eternity behind us, is now, and will always be, the Logos and the Son of Man. Not only the Logos, and the Son of Man. He said, I am the Son of Man. That means, I have passed through the idea of man in the total wisdom of the Father and of myself. So, while being on earth, Christ was feeling like anyone around. He was conscious of everybody. What is he now? As the King, the Divine Majesty in the Kingdom of the Heavens, which is inside every one of us also. You read it in the Bible. What was he feeling and what is he feeling? He said, you come blessed ones, because when I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. When I was naked, you gave me something to put on. When I was in the prison, that means in the material body, incarnated, you visited me. And I told him, sir, when did we see you? Hungry or thirsty or naked? He said, in so much you have done to one of these least of brethren of mine, you have done it to me. Because he was and he is in every human being. He has proved it. How? When he was speaking to his disciples, giving them instructions, and to the wise one who visited him, to Philip and to Nicodem, he said, the flesh is nothing. It is the spirit which is giving life. He said, you are spirit. God is spirit, and those who approach him should approach him in spirit and in truth. And Yohanan the Baptist said, I baptize you in water for the forgiveness of your sins, but you are coming after me. His first cousin, Joshua the Christ, will baptize you in fire and in spirit. In fire and in spirit. It is in the Bible. Who cares to understand what it means? This is what's wrong. They don't just try to understand what it means. And so, where is Christ now? Where is Joshua the Christ now? Was Joshua a man or the Christ? Just a human being who lived 33 years, was crucified, and he passed away to oblivion. No, he is now. In every one of us. And what, as he said, the one man is doing to the other, good or evil, it's doing it to him. Does he feel pain? Yes. What did he say himself? Seeing people tortured and others torturing people. My soul, as Joshua the Christ, is grieved unto death. Now, Christ, Joshua the Christ, was speaking in the Greek language, because being himself in flesh and a sin, a Greco-Israelite, he was preaching mainly in the Greek language, in Aramaic, in Latin, and in many other languages. So, yes, Joshua the Christ is grieved to death as human being, as the Logos. That's another matter. We don't know as Logos how he's feeling. So, why did he come to the world, Joshua the Christ? Because he's telling it in his parables, but why? To wake us up and tell us you are gods and you are in deep slumber with a little petty self living in sufferings, in pain, in sorrow. In the world of separateness, the one fighting the other and causing harm the one to the other. That's why he came and was humanized and incarnated. To wake us up to our divine nature. So, yes, nice words, very good words. But there is no way how. How we should be sure about all that? He has shown the way. I am the way, the truth, and life. Which is the way? The way, we have to cover it with our own legs. And you have been given feet just to cover the way. He has shown us the way. By studying the phenomenon of life, which is our present-day self, we must try to understand the various levels of selfhood and see where really we are standing now. Well, people are not standing on the seventh step of the ladder of evolution. Why not? All human beings on the same level. Because they are not. They don't want to. If they want, they can. Because the infinite beingness and the Logos, as the lot of selfhood, is giving us in abundance the mind to use it. That's the ladder to ascend, the mind. And the mind has not the handful of earth which are the brains in the skull. So everybody has the right to breathe and live as a human body. And everybody has the right to the daily bread which comes from heaven, which is the mind. Do we use the mind? We are all persuaded by Christ to use the mind and know the truth. Know the truth and the truth will set you free. That's clear. So, this ladder is the mind. And every step is to develop ladder with many, many, many steps is the mind. And using it, we have to develop in our selfhood the various kinds of consciousness. Now, by observation, what we see? This consciousness is not only to serve the selfhood, but also to serve all the other phenomena of life around us. Because the mind is everywhere. It's used by the holy archangels, in the trees and the animals. And what we find as phenomena of life, reaching this stage of the selfhood, that the stones, the crystals, the metals, everything, they have a kind of sensitivity. They are sensitive to the weather, to the etheric vibrations, to electricity, to magnetism. Each of these elements we call matter, because matter is solid mind, has a certain sensitivity. If you touch a piece of glass to a loaded wire with electricity, it will not catch the electricity. But if you get a piece of iron and touch it, that will shake you. Why? A piece of matter and the one and the other. Or a piece of wood. If you wet the wood, you put water in, dare to touch a loaded wire. Why? You leave away in a damp weather a piece of cord. That will not affect. If you leave a piece of iron, you'll see it rusty. Why? So, even what we call life in the metals and in the gross matter, that is what we'll observe and say, sensitivity. Do human beings have this sensitivity? Yes. Because a human being has everything. We have that sensitivity. Because we have the mind matter in our body also. Then we see this sensitivity in various grades. You see a nice flower outside, the sun rises, and then the flower turns to the sun. Why? That's a higher state of sensitivity than the sensitivity of the metals or the crystals. Now, we see in the animal life, we see sensitivity plus a kind of subconsciousness, which you call instinct, the instinctive kind of consciousness. Do human beings have this instinctive subconsciousness? Of course they have it. And by studying, meditating and concentration and observation, one finds out that he has the sensitivity, he has the instinctive consciousness, and you have the subconsciousness. Most of the living forms around us in the animal kingdom are expressing this subconsciousness. This subconsciousness is common to all kinds of life around us. And all those modes of consciousness are in the Holy Spirit. So everything is governed by the Holy Spirit and the holy archangels who are creating the elemental angels using the total wisdom to give us all this phenomena of life all around us. Now we have what we call subconsciousness in the human being. Of course, subconsciousness in the human being has been greatly misunderstood. We are using this word for different modes of existence. You have to study them. Then what we have more to the human being, which we don't see in the animal kingdom around us, is self-consciousness. From this point, the human being is God. So, developing now this self-consciousness to higher levels. Now, I'm asking you, do human beings all around us, even in the so-called civilized world, have a self-consciousness? Or they are living subconsciously? They think they have a self-consciousness while they are living subconsciously. And they have to work until they create in themselves that self-consciousness even of the present day personality. Because we have now the self of the present day personality in the world of separateness. To develop it into what? Into the super consciousness. And after that, to the self super consciousness. By developing in us what I call attunement to something. But it needs training. Much training. Not only years of training. Centuries of training. And then develop it still higher. Until we reach that super consciousness, self-super consciousness, which is what we call oneness, becoming one. Becoming one with what? With anything, with any form, with the archangels, with the Logos, with God. So, reaching to that stage of self-superconsciousness, the what I call at-one-ment, then you know who you are. You are what? What you were always without knowing it. God. And what is God now? a super conscious being composing the absolute infinite beingness, the Logos, and the absolute infinite beingness, the Holy Spirit. Now, if you understand these two great, great powers which are in us, in the kingdom of the heavens which is in us, and how to develop them, then you understand what is the purpose in life, what is life, what should life be. Now, as human beings are today, they are living. I say that they are subconsciously living. They don't know because they cannot meditate. They cannot use subconsciously the mind. What Joshua the Christ was calling these common people all around us, even now in the civilized countries. It is clear there. A fellow approached Christ, Joshua, told him, "Sir, I want to follow you. You are teaching things divine. I want to follow you. But my father and my mother are living. Yet, wait until they pass over, and then, of course, I will follow you." And what did Joshua the Christ reply to him? "You follow me. And let the dead bury their own dead. Let the dead bury their own dead." So for Joshua the Christ, the common people all around and today as they are considered dead and not really living. So, now what's life? What did he say? "I am life and the resurrection." What does it mean, the resurrection? A word which has been so much misunderstood. The waking up to what we are, that's the resurrection. Resurrection does not mean our material body to die and be recomposed and we enter again in that dirty sack we call it material body. That isn't resurrection. So many think that the word resurrection means the material body to be resurrected. No, resurrection means to wake up into your own state and nature. That is the resurrection. He said, "I am the life and the resurrection. And he who believes in me will have everlasting life." Again, I suggest that each one should have the New Testament as his or her best friend and enter in the great, great meanings, especially of the sayings of Joshua the Christ. So, we said enough theory now. There's something practical now which you have to do. What do we have to do now? We are living in a material body. And I tell you that your material body has in it, or it is in, your etheric double. How many of you know that? Though you are using that etheric double subconsciously. That's why I said a human being is living subconsciously. I am telling you that also you have a psychical body with its etheric double. Who knows that? St. Paul mentioned it. I spoke about the noetical body. You are using it subconsciously, but who knows it? These are the various kinds of consciousness of the Logos. And what St. John the Evangelist said, the selfhood is life, and it is delight to every man, and delight shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not comprehend it. What does it mean? Just surely Christ, the selfhood is in every one of us. Everyone has a petty little sense of selfhood, just centered on a name and the body, a female or male name and the body. Without knowing its nature, that selfhood has life. And so, Joshua or the Logos is the selfhood. In him is life. And the life is the light of men, giving them this selfhood. And the light shines. It is the mind, it shines. Who can use it to shine? In the darkness. And the darkness, which means you are present, the personality, does not comprehend it. It is just the first sentences with which St. John the Evangelist begins his Gospel. Great wisdom. Yes, but great wisdom, we must find it out. We must work to make it true for us, to work for it, by using the mind. So, what is the aim of the system for the research of the truth? We are just having it now. What for? There must be a reason. Just to teach human, every human being, the way to the light. How? By training the self, the petty little self of the personality, to raise that self to higher levels of consciousness and self-realization. By teaching people how to study and know the nature of the mind substance composing the psychical body and its etheric double, controlling the emotions, controlling the desires, controlling that self of the personality, controlling the human egoism. And then using the mind as super substance now, as thought, right thought and reason. And when one will do that, he'll find his way back. Joshua the Christ gave a parable. There was, he said, a woman who got 3 measures of flour, mixed them with water until the whole thing became leaven. It was Christ teaching bakers how to make bread. What did he mean? Who is that woman? The personality. Taking these 3 measures, the material body, the psychical body, and the noetical body, mixing them with the water, that means with the mind, with the reason, until all of them became one living. That's what Christ meant by that. Great God. So what we are supposed to do? Know the nature of our material body, of matter. Study it. By studying it, we'll find the total wisdom of the archangels which have built it and who are working every moment in the material body for us. Do you live in your material body by right or by grace? By right, How? By living a life which causes illnesses to your material body. The time the illnesses and the wounds and the broken bones you are doing on the material body. The holy archangels are constantly working to repair the harm you are causing, to close up wounds and make bones join. That's what happens. Everybody will notice that. Everybody will notice that the holy archangels in his material body are working continuously to keep it in good order. So we as personality now, the way you are living, do we deserve to live in that material body built up with such a great wisdom? It's up to you to decide. And then, a step forward. If you decide now, as your personality, the petty self, to take control. Say at this moment, you are the victim of circumstances without studying what are emotions, what are thoughts, being unhappy and all that. Now, you decide to know the truth, to set you free from the illusions, from the prejudices, from pain, from sorrow. And then you start changing things, studying seriously the nature of desire, of emotion, seeing your subconsciousness, what was the outcome all through the time which has passed of your surrendering yourself to emotions, uncontrolled emotions and desires, creating in your subconsciousness hatreds, jealousies, weaknesses, so many things. Now you have to decide to study all these things and free yourself from the consequences of all that. How? By using the reason now, using the mind. You start using the mind to control the emotions, to remedy the illnesses of the body and of the emotional body. That means of your psychical body. But is that the aim of it? That would be a great, great gain, because you would succeed doing that. But the greatest gain is subconsciously at the beginning, finding yourself. Who am I? Who can do it? I can't control this material body, therefore I am not a material body. I can control my emotions, my desires, therefore I am not that, because they are changing. I can even correct things, overcome weaknesses. There are so many weaknesses leading to so many kinds of evil. And then now I'm using the mind. Who am I? Who can do that? You will get a reply from your guardian angel. He'll tell you, my love, you are God. We are God. Wake up. What is another gain after doing that? You will come without knowing it in conscious contact with the archangels. At the beginning, you will feel that they use the intuition to show you the light. And you say, yes, now I understand. I am thinking, I think I'm thinking rightly, but this thought is not my thought. It came from outside. Mistake, it came from within, because the Holy Archangel is in you and not outside. I had many people saying to me, Pascale, you know, what is inspiration? I said, you find out. He says, now, in my meditation, yes, I was thinking like that. It came to me And I knew that that thought was not mine. It came from without. I said, no, you are mistaken. It didn't come from without. It came from within, from the kingdom of the heavens, which is in you. Some of them, of course, are feeling afraid at the beginning, but it needs courage. The first contact with your guardian angel, who sometimes gives very bad slaps when you overdo it, with God, of course, stinks of consciousness, but he's a loving archangel, very loving archangel, quite one is doing what is good to do. And then, apart from the inspiration and the intuition, you'll see them. Will they materialize? No. With your psychical eyes. Because you will develop in the meantime the psychical vision, which is clairvoyance. You will hear, which is clairaudience. Is that all? No. Because by training one day, sitting you find, oh, my body is here and I'm there. Where am I? Where am I? Then you'll come back, entering your body. And you know that you are outside of your body many, many times without knowing it. Now you develop the self-consciousness. Of course, there are ways in the inmost circle of our system. The brother instructor and guide is giving instructions how to make self-conscious exosomatosis. Then the real gain is that you know there is no death. By reasoning, you are convinced there is no death. Because in every 24 hours, certain hours, you are entering in a state of nothingness. You are in a dream, you are in a sleep without any dream. Yet you wake up and recompose yourself, which means that that state of nothingness you have entered is not injuring your personality or yourself. It is quite independent. And you feel recomposing yourself. Now you have a greater proof. I am not that body there. I can move wherever I like to go. Of course, we'll be instructed how to do that. Because it is not only the material world you will be able to move about. You'll find yourself in the psychical world. And you must be sure that you'll not find in the exosomatosis yourself in any self-created hell. So, you will be taught also how to build up your paradise, if you call it like that, and pull down your dungeon, the hell you have built already. But we said by controlling the emotions and the desires, and freeing ourselves from the weaknesses, hatred, malice, the feeling of attacking and all that, we already demolish our hell. Because I'm telling you, when a fellow passes over to the other side, who knows where? At any moment it may happen to everybody, by accident, by illness, by heart failure. There are many ways. Nobody will find himself or herself in any hell or in any paradise. They are not already. So we have from now to demolish that prison or our hell, and with the same material, which is the mind, build up a better place for us. Place. Because in the other side, it is the sense of place. Christ said, I go. In the house of my Father, there are many, many mansions. I got to prepare place for you, the sense of place. Now, of course, we'll think, what is the difference between place and space? There are many, many things. One, seeker of the truth has to engage himself with many, many branches of study. And always there is the reward. Yes. Now we'll make a meditation. Relax completely. Feel you are relaxed from the legs, thighs, abdomen, chest. Breathe deeply and comfortably. Silence down completely in you every emotion. You have to start now to think slowly. You feel you are in that material body of yours now, everywhere in the material body. Head, chest, hands, abdomen, feet. Feel you are in your material body. I said, start thinking slowly. You have to slow down the way of thinking. Who am I? Don't be in a hurry. Put this question slowly. Who am I in this material body? Is this material body mine? I am in it. I am in it. Who am I? Forget your name. Forget your human form. Put the question directly. You want to investigate your selfhood. Not the material body, the gross matter. The matter is nothing. The spirit is life-giving. You are the spirit. Who am I? What am I? Casting away from myself emotions, desires, thoughts. Yet I remain myself. I am I. That I-ness I want to know and feel that it is myself, not my desires, my weaknesses, or my thoughts. All these are changing. But I am not changing. I am the everlasting life. Whether I am in a dreamless, deep sleep, I am recomposing my petty little time and place self, I am the same I-ness. I am the life and the truth. What am I? An entity receiving impressions from outside, from the material world. Yes, at that. But I am more than that. Much, much more than that. I am I, this I-ness, myself, I want to know, entering the real self-realization. What am I then? You'll receive the answer not now. Maybe sometime you'll be sleeping and you wake up and you know the answer. The holy archangels and your guardian angel heard you. And when time will come, they'll think it is the time. They will reply to your question. Now, breathe deeply and comfortably. I can change the rhythm of my breath. Yet all the time I was breathing subconsciously, not knowing it. My breath being controlled by the holy archangels. But now I can take control and breathe willingly to the rhythm I want. Of course, we'll be taught this kind of rhythm according to the beats of your heart, so that we'll get control. Control of what? Of your emotions. Because you are influencing also the psychical body through the etheric double of the psychical body. Breathe deeply. You can change the rhythm of your breath. You can become master of your home, of your material body. Now you can influence your subconsciousness, the subconscious mind in your personality. Say with your mind, I want perfect health to be in this material body of mine. The archangels are laughing now. What are we doing all the time? Not to restore good health in your body? Of course, but you have to realize that. By saying so, you tell your subconscious not to counteract to the work of the archangels. You help them now. Breathe deeply and say to yourself mentally, I want perfect health to be in this material body of mine. Continue breathing deeply and comfortably.
Je suis en train de faire un peu de temps.